Okay. Who is your best student, Maxine? Did you have a best student out of the Motown?
Well, you know, when I answer that, I know you will think that I'm kidding. But as I said, each one was a different type of flower, and there really was no best, because they all were great in their way. And as I said earlier, no one ever said to me, I don't feel good and I'm moody. Now, if they said, I don't feel good, I could understand that, but they had been informed early, do you really want to be an entertainer? It's one third glamour and the rest is hard work. I'd say, for example, you're performing and we have a sold out house, maybe 3,000 or 5,000 people or more, and something happens to your mother just before you're ready to go out on stage, will you be able to step over your mother and go out and do the show without it showing? I said, that might sound a little cold, but there isn't anything you could do anyway, because we would have to get her to a hospital, but to feel sad. And then, as you perform, it could not show that there had been a problem of some kind backstage. Then, after you through performing, naturally we would have maybe a police escort and escort you to the hospital. Do you think you can do that? Because if we were to tell the audience that you could not come out and appear because something happened to your mother, they would never believe that, and they would tear the place up, and the image would not be good for you. Or would you rather have a job where you could work from 9 to 5 and you have your sick days and you can take off? The show must go on. So at an early age, and they learned to work hard, and then I treated them like they were kings and queens before they made a quarter. And then they had to act like they were kings and queens. We had no money. We were traveling around into clubs and into the theaters around the country. And they were sad looking places. They were nothing like the Copacabana. And many a time I've gotten a broom to clean it up, and use newspapers on the dirty shelves. And then I was fortunate enough that I knew how to dye shoes, because on that day we had to buy the inexpensive shoes, and shoes were matching the gowns in those days. And so, as you know, when you clean a silk shoe, it won't stand very many cleanings. And so I could dye, and I also bead it. So I could go out and buy an inexpensive dress, and I had an excellent dressmaker that worked with me, and maybe it would be two sizes too large or whatever, because it would be on sale. I would buy it anyway, and she would take it up, and maybe I would splash it with rhinestones or whatever. And this is the sort of treatment they had. And then from Motown, they had to go to school 2 hours with me. And then we had a person with us called Harvey. His name was Harvey Fuqua. He was a producer at Artist Development. And then we had a gentleman by the name of Maurice King, who had a large band at one time. And he became the music controller, the vocal instructor, and arranger. And then we had a gentleman by the name of Johnny Allen. He played the piano and he was also an arranger. And everybody that came to Motown had to come through Artist Development. It was 2 hours with me, 2 hours with the vocal instructor. If they were on the road, then of course they got an itinerary and they knew what they had to do. And this is how we built the artist to where they are today.
That's amazing.
And travel all over the country. Then as we began to make a little bit more money, instead of using newspaper, I bought beautiful hand towels. And I'd tear off a piece and put it. See, I find that it isn't a matter of the money, how much money you have. It's the know-how. Because sometime, if you you become very rich overnight, sometimes people act very strange or odd because it's too much too soon. So if you really find out who you are in life and learn the technique of putting things together and good taste and good behavior, I think that you're pretty safe, and then you have to continue to look for a challenge. There's no such thing as I have made it. Made it where? You see, there's plenty of room up at the top, but staying there is a secret, and staying happy.
How involved was Barry Gordy in your part of the school? I mean, how involved was he in?
Not at all.
Not at all?
Not at all. It was left to me, you see. I knew nothing about the records, and when we went on the road. Now, we had a club here called the Driftwood Lounge, and we would work with the artists for weeks, months, a year or more. When we felt that we had them ready for the public, well, they would appear at this club for 10 days, and we would watch them very closely like they do for Broadway. You know, they go to the different cities and perform and revamp, rewrite, and get it together. And when we felt that we really had the artists at their peak, then the Copacabana, when we felt we had them ready for national performance. They were told that there is such a thing as a recording artist, or entertainer, or singer, but the performer is the greatest of them all. And that's what we had in mind for them. And it took years.
What was the first artist that you worked with that made it to the Copacabana? Do you remember?
Yes, the first one was the Supremes. It wasn't Diana Ross at that particular time, but the Supremes, and then Marvin Gaye. And I'm proud to say that his son is my godson. So it was sort of like a family. We really took an interest in the artists. And we felt that it could be done. It had nothing to do with color, and we proved that. And that they should have class and be treated as beautiful human beings. And we expected them to act as beautiful human beings, which they were.
I read a statement that said that you prepared them to have dinner at Buckingham Palace in the White House.
That's right. And and then it wasn't always easy. I remember when we were at the Copacabana, they worked very hard, all the Motown artists. They were taught that. Because if we had to have a chorus line or a lot of people on the show, then they would make less money because you would have to pay for people. So if the person came to see you, you'd have to be able to perform at least 1 hour and 45 minutes or a 2 hour show. So oftentimes when they finished a performance, not only were they wringing wet, but their shoes were wringing wet. So I would have them undress. We had robes to put on, you know. We had a set for company and one to lounge around. And they had a makeup table. I did everything early. so that they would feel great as they grew, and kept the rooms beautiful. I'd go out and buy flowers, kept them happy. I didn't want them to act ugly. I kept their uniforms, we call whatever they performed in a uniform. I kept those in my room as we traveled, so I could see where they need cleaning or spotting or what needed to be done. So they got very fine treatment, and Mr. Gordy was in favor of that. And I also shopped for them, and maybe sometime while they were sleeping, I would explore the neighborhood so I could tell them what was around. And we wanted them to have some sort of relaxation, but in the entertainment field, most of the places that you would be interested in and that would be exciting is closed by the time you're through working. So you need to unwind. So with the Supremes and a few others, we bowled, see. So we didn't get to bed, maybe till morning or however they felt so that they could unwind. They weren't heavy drinkers, but we did everything we could to keep them happy and to keep them reaching for a new challenge.
So talking about the Supremes, when you see Diana today, Diana Ross, how much of what you taught her do you see? Is she just sort of the epitome of that class and regalness that you so worked for?
Oh, I'm so glad you asked me that. Because when Diana appeared on Broadway, you see, everything that I stressed, they found to be true. Because on Broadway, there's supposed to be musicals and plays, not a rhythm and blues singer. But as I said earlier, if you are good, excellent, unusual, and you have something to offer, you don't have to be the greatest singer, but class, finesse. You have to be an actor or an actress. So I gave that to all of our artists. They can act, they know how to treat people, they're disciplined themselves, and they know how to dress. They don't have to be a great singer. You shouldn't have to wear odd clothes, you know. And so these are the sort of things we tried to instill in the artists. I hadn't seen Diane appear, I guess maybe 5 or 6 or 7 years when she became Diana Ross in the Supremes. And then after a while, Diana Ross. And she was appearing on Broadway in New York. I got a plane and I went. I didn't go near her, I didn't go backstage. I just wanted to see if she was using the things that I had taught. So at the end of her performance, one of Mr. Gordy's aides said to her, "Do you know who's in the audience?" And she said, "Who?" Said, "Maxine Powell." Said, "Where?" And they pointed to me. She brought me on stage, sat to another hugging and a kissing. She was so warm. And she introduced me as the person that had taught her everything she knew. And behind that, I was interviewed by Time Magazine. And then again, she appeared here. And I watched her stage technique. And I said to her when I went backstage, I said, "Diana, I was so proud." I said, "You didn't make a bad step. Your hip bones were forward. I teach walking a straight line or crossing over. There is such a thing as stage technique and winning the audience." She said, "Miss Powell, I want you to know something." She said, "In my work, as you know, every now and then, no matter what I pay for a uniform to perform in, I have to replace it. And after a while, I don't care what my hit record is. After a while, I need a new one. She says, every time I'm on stage, you're out there with me. That was very rewarding.
What a fabulous tribute. Let's change tape. That's a great story.